people, unfortunately.
I mean, this impacted so many people. We've seen earlier this year impacts from Debbie. That was like your area, kind of Gulf Coast-ish, up into mine, then back into South Carolina. But that did not impact the entire Southeast. Like during that storm, Atlanta had virtually nothing. My area had 10 plus inches of rain. The Gulf Coast obviously had some wind. But this one expanded. I mean, it was like Florida into a little bit of Alabama, Georgia, the Carolinas, then into the Appalachians. And definitely over the last probably 20 to 25 years, I saw that this is like a top five deadliest storm. And it was all aspects of it. It made landfall as a category 4 from the National Hurricane Center. Yeah. So you had the wind with it, and then you had the rains into Appalachians and those areas. So, again, it's all about impacts, and hopefully anyone that was watching us, we got the best we could, those impacts out ahead of the storm.
Yeah, no doubt. And I just want to take a look, because this is a storm system that stayed 100-plus miles away from Tampa Bay, Jeremy, and yet these are the 5 tidal gauges around Tampa Bay, and each and every one of them hit a record value. And some of these tidal gauges, Jeremy, go back 80 plus years. So for example, St. Petersburg, the old record was nearly a 4-foot storm surge in Hurricane Elena back in 1985. They did 6.25 feet. Most of these set records last year with the Dahlia. Clearwater Beach, almost 7 feet. The old record was 4 feet back in the storm of the century in 1993. So this was a remarkable, remarkable impact, and it stayed 100 miles off the shoreline.
Yeah, and then it made that landfall. I think it was like 11:10 on Thursday, on the 26th. And then remember how the National Hurricane Center, their track, they did very good up, I think, until the landfall. It did keep moving north-northeast, though.
Yes.
And that's why my area ended up getting into more of the core of the winds. And our inland counties, one of them in Bacon County, Alma area, set a record for the highest wind gusts ever measured for that observation site, 100 miles per hour.
Wow.
And there are just, I mean, there are so many trees down in that area. Power is still out. In Savannah, we had a peak gust at our airport of 76 miles per hour. I worked that day. I got in a little before 1 p.m. on that Thursday, and then I covered a tornado warning that expired at 1:45 a.m. I left work that day, and driving home was an experience. I posted some video. There were billboards that were being shredded. There were huge overhang road signs on the interstate that were coming down. There were big branches, some trees starting to get toppled, and it looked like a lot of people the next day said there was so much lightning with that storm. And I go, I don't think there was almost, there was any, it was all power flashes. So I posted video of that. Once I got home, I have kind of a horizon view towards the city, and it was just like nonstop flashes.
Well, and look, I mean, just for perspective, even today, on Tuesday after the storm made landfall, South Carolina still 21.5% of residents without power. And you can clearly see, I mean, if this isn't the corridor of the worst of the weather where that storm lifted through, this is the county by county kind of breakdown of who is without power. And obviously the blues, that's going to be the lower amount of residents, but you see those yellows, reds, and nearly black. The nearly black, kind of goes without saying, is nearly black. Those counties are like the 95% or greater amounts. So you're looking at significant power outages, even live this morning, my friend.
Yeah, and in Savannah, you don't have to really hunt to find no power. I mean, there's still pockets without power. I went roughly about 40 hours at my home without power. And then just last night, got internet back. I was texting you that, hey, I might not have Wi-Fi for this morning. We'll see what happens. There's definitely people a lot worse off in some of these areas where trees are just wrapped around power lines still. So I think the estimation originally from Georgia Power in our area was at the end of today at 10 p.m. people would be restored. I don't know if that's going to quite happen because there's still a lot of work to do in some spots, but hopefully it's sooner than later, because this isn't a tropical system that moved through and then all of a sudden it brought in that cool air from the northwest. We've had highs consistently 87 to 90 since it moved through.
Yeah, well, and we can't forget that there's more to track in the tropics, right?
Yes.
The storm system is continuing to fire up on all other facets. So we need to get back out and see what's doing in the tropics right now, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, and it's been busy. The last 2 to 3 weeks clearly has been the busiest part of the entire Atlantic hurricane season. And there's more to track, as you mentioned. A couple of them may end up being very strong hurricanes, potentially major hurricanes, but they should stay way out into the Atlantic. But we're also keeping an eye on something that may try to get going Caribbean to Gulf.
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, we had talked about, like, is this potentially a part of our new cycle that comes through, or is this kind of part of the old cycle? So let's just kind of get an idea of what we're looking at right now. Okay, so in the Caribbean, this is kind of the next area we're watching. And Jeremy, we always talk about these CAG lows, basically Central American gyres, what it is. So moisture from the Pacific pulls in, moisture from the Caribbean, and moisture from the Gulf. And you oftentimes see these little spin-up lows. They're very, very typical, but the Hurricane Center has been watching this. We've been watching this, and certainly there is a concern for development. A lot of people are talking about this on the social channels, and I would say that the hype machine has already started. So let's really deep dive into this and make sure everybody knows kind of the latest information that we have here.
And I think every single person watching us right knows we are not the hype machine.
Right. Very, like, if you're here for that, don't.
Yeah,
don't.
We are like the anti-hype machine. And I even posted last night, knowing that this is still sort of part of our current cycle. Again, when we talk about that, we're talking about our hurricane season forecast we put out March the 1st. We kind of give you the roadmap or the groundwork of some of the higher likelihoods of development within the season. And while I didn't per se have... I did a whole write-up, and this is tied to a pattern that we were like, hey, this kind of overlaps with the new pattern starting to set up, but we definitely think it's still the current pattern, and it's one we've talked about. This is a complex one where there could be like two lows that form, and it's always wanted to favor the Yucatan.
Right.
Always the low wants to go somewhere near the Yucatan, and then it almost like curves back sometimes towards South Florida. So that's something we'll have to watch. And as I mentioned last night to viewers in my area, I said, this is not Helene part two.
Right.
This is not Helene part two for my area.
And to that point, you know, whether or not the Gulf Coast of Florida sees an impact from this remains to be seen, but this is not going to end up lifting into those areas that had the catastrophic flooding up by you, Jeremy.
Yeah. So there's going to be a front and probably a high that ends up moving in. This is actually going to be such a long duration that we're going to have to track this. Some models drag this into like the middle part of next week. So it may be something that sort of gets going. A lot of models, it looks very broad, whatever low forms in the Gulf.
Right. So let's get right to it and take a look at some of the models, right? First off, Hurricane Center has a 10% chance of development over the next 2 days' time, a 40% chance of development over the next 7 days' time. That percentage was higher late last week into early in the weekend, when the models were all kind of consistent in some form of a hurricane forming. Then they started to back off just a little bit. Hurricane Center went, and deservedly so, from a 50% development chance to a 40% development chance, because the models were not all in consistency. And remember, consistency with computer models breeds confidence. But I would also add, this morning, maybe there's a little bit of a shift to a stronger direction. This wishy-washy thing is very normal with systems that are either not formed or are just starting to form. So to that point, Jeremy, you know, we have a pretty good idea that there's going to be low pressure developing. We have a pretty good idea that it's probably going to end up being a pretty decent rainfall event to like Florida. We have a pretty good idea it's going to be a gusty event, but outside of that, does this become a tropical depression, tropical storm, or hurricane? I don't think we have enough consistency to breed any confidence in that respect.
Correct. And that's why we're at this point, Eric and I are trying to use some clues that we sort of know about. That last part of the pattern that delivered Helene, I mean, bam, we forecast that back on March the 1st. We said September 20th to 28th. We said that sort of northeastern Gulf area was the prime location. That's where that moved. That was always the number one absolute most impactful part of the pattern for my area. Now, this one coming up doesn't really favor my area as much. So that's why we're thinking Hey, maybe that North Central Gulf down to South Florida, keep an eye on it.
Yeah, and this one has not produced much over the last cycles, but does that mean that this last little piece of it does? Well, you know, it remains to be seen, right? So here's a look. We'll start with the American GFS model, okay? And let's just take a kind of a deep dive into this and see where we're at, okay? So first off, what we're watching for is pressures lowering in the Gulf. There's one piece of energy, we'll call it. All right, then as that does its thing, there's another piece of energy around Sunday that forms, and then a third piece of energy that forms, and the models are kind of doing this little weird Fujiwara. There's the Panhandle, there's the Yucatan low. They dance around each other, and potentially we see this little landfalling thing, kind of nature coast of Florida. Looking at winds on this, Jeremy, it would be probably a tropical storm, maybe a hurricane, according to this run of the GFS. But my concern wouldn't necessarily be in the intensity of this thing, but rather be in the idea of more onshore driving wind into places like Pinellas County and Hillsborough County, places in Tampa Bay that just do not need this sort of thing.
Yeah, and even you could start developing a fairly persistent east wind on the eastern side of Florida. So then you'd have to start watching, obviously, a rough surf, rip currents, and then beach erosion again.
Right, right. So that's one run of one model. If I take you back, okay, and just go, that's the 6Z. If I go to the 0Z model of the GFS, it's got something, but it just kind of sits out in the Gulf of Mexico and then moves through and fades out by like Monday the 14th. So this is where Jeremy was taught. And then if we go two runs back, there's another. There's definitely low pressure forming. Does it tighten up to be a tropical thing or not? You know, literally the GFS has kind of been showing something. Each run, something. And if I go over to, and I'll just do this real quick here, because we don't need to spend too much time on it at this point. If I go over to the 00Z European, for example, there's something. Is it too organized? No, it looks sloppy and into South Florida. If I go back two runs to the 12Z European, it's almost identical. Something sloppy around Florida. So to me, I'm more concerned, Jeremy, with at the moment, a big rain event. Do we end up developing something tropical? We need to wait days until we can get enough confidence.
Yeah. And I think that 40% is a good indication. The National Hurricane Center is kind of like, hey, we think something may form, but we're not even super confident. And maybe it's even outside of that 7-day window.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a lot of just kind of wait and see. And I like what you showed there, because the models are picking up on what we've talked about, how sometimes this part of the pattern has a couple different low pressure areas. Yeah. Like sometimes it's been near the Yucatan, and then another one either near east of South Florida.
Well, and this was the very first time it happened. It was like rolling near the Carolinas, and then another one formed. So each time, and that's what we're seeing on the GFS, is this thing around, not the Carolinas, I'm sorry, but it was like something was forming along the Northern Gulf, and then another one formed below it. We saw that. Was that November?
Yes, November, kind of, we had it November 14th to 18th, right around there.
So that's, this has always been such a complex part of the pattern, and at least meteorologically, I've always been quite happy that nothing really formed here because it's complex, but here we're entering into it. Maybe it does want to do something. It's a complex part of the pattern.
Yeah, and I always feel like the impacts for you from this have mainly been rain for parts of Florida, so we'll see if that's the case. Again, I think people would take rain as long as it's manageable over tropical impacts again. So
well, and no, I was just going to say, though, like, you know, but previous cycles, like I know Southwest Florida got severe weather, Southeast Florida got severe weather. So, you know, definitely watching the southern half, I think, of the peninsula. It's too early to tell, but just the cycling of this would dictate that.
But I think of the least likely solutions, kind of having clues and hints of this, is something that takes the Helene track. We're not really thinking that right now. We think that'd be on the very lower end chance of possibilities right now.
So. Yeah, no. I think that this would be more of a kind of like crossing the Florida Peninsula and moving out to sea, which would be very welcome news for so many people. Not in Florida, certainly, but for the for the Carolinas and through Tennessee, et cetera, et cetera. So for right now, again, I think the biggest piece to this puzzle is there is low confidence in any part other than there's going to be something forming, whether it's a big, wet, sloppy low or something else, we don't know. And so let's not freak out about anything any more than that.
Yeah. And one thing comment I got from viewers with Helene, and I'll just mention this for people on my end watching. Yeah. I know your station, you went nonstop covering Helene, yeah. correct? When yes. did you kind of start your coverage? But not the continuous.
I mean, the overall coverage was for a week plus, but I think we went into continuous Tuesday morning, something okay. like that. Yeah, Tuesday morning.
All right. So we, at my station, we had, at one point we had 7 tornado warnings active in our area, and that was definitely a handful. So what we did is we just straight looked at some velocities, and we really focused on the maybe 2 or 3 areas that had the strongest rotation, right. people that were most in danger.
Yeah.
And then we stayed, WJCL, we stayed on the entire night. And I'll tell you what, I can't believe the messages I'm getting from people, how grateful they were, because so many people started to lose power. And one thing I kept saying over and over and over is, right now, download our app, download yeah. our app, yeah. download our app, because if your power goes out, you may still have internet access, so you can continue to watch our right. coverage. And we were the only station that stayed on continuously from like late afternoon all the way through Friday morning. And sometimes you're like, you do the coverage and you're like, I really hope some people found that useful.
Yeah.
But the support and comments we've gotten saying thank you for staying yeah. on, I think it's a testament to what you do and what we try to do up here to just keep everyone safe. So yeah. that's always our goal when we do tropical forecasting, severe weather coverage, is kind of just let people know, hey, this is what we're thinking.
Right.
And if you're in danger, we'll let you know.
And it's not like we do it because it's fun. It's not fun to stand right. there and to talk for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. And like, you know, Jeremy and I literally work polar opposite shifts. For me, waking up at midnight is just not fun, but we do it because right. there is a genuine, there's a genuine responsibility we feel to inform people. So to that point, yeah, Jeremy, I applaud you and your team. I know I applaud everybody in this newsroom for working horrible hours and for talking too much. But if it gets truly information, truly vital information out, then I'm grateful for it. And I would say when my family was on the cruise this weekend, there were a lot of people that watched our coverage and felt the exact same way. So mm-hmm. for some people, they may get frustrated, but to others, yeah. you know, we're here to help. And you know, you're the, what's the name of your weather team? What do you call yourselves?
Storm Tracker.
That's because you're tracking storms. We call ourselves First yeah. Warning Weather. Our yeah. goal is to give you the first warning. So there's a reason why we call it. It's not just some little fancy logo on the top left corner of the screen. That's kind of what we live by, what we do, and right. why we do it. So, yeah, at this point, let's not freak out. Jeremy, I would imagine you and I are probably going to do another Tracking the Tropics this week just to yeah. let everybody know and get updates as new model data comes in.
I think, yeah, maybe we'll do our best to do that like Friday or something. Yeah. We'll talk, but we'll kind of see how the models look. Maybe this doesn't end up looking like much, and right. it ends up just being a rainmaker for someone. So yeah, the names now, we've just been piling these up. So I believe we're up to 11 with Leslie probably forming in the next day,
yep.
maybe 2.
Yeah, yeah. So there you go. The average is 10.9. So we're right about where we should be for this time of year, climatologically speaking. Still behind last year, but it's not a race.
No. And also, so we'll probably have storm number 12 within a day or whatever.
Yeah.
If anything forms in the Gulf, that'd be 13. And then it does look a little quieter after that, thankfully.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we'll have to kind of see how the back half of October shapes up. And then right. maybe you get a storm or two in November. We'll see how that plays out, but we'll be watching it closely.
Yeah. So this was one thing that kind of caught Jeremy off guard when I was putting the graphic together. So our ACE score sits at 78.8. The 30-year average is 95.5. So yes, for the moment, even though Helene became a major hurricane, it wasn't there for very, very long. So we didn't really pile up the ACE like that. We definitely played some catch up, but we're still running just a little behind the 30-year average in ACE points.
I think we're going to get back to average or jump ahead because yeah. we have Kirk forecast to be a major hurricane. I think there's a chance Leslie could make a run at that too. And those will be long duration systems in the open Atlantic.
Yeah.
So that A score will start to pile up. 120, as you see, there's the average season. And I think we'll quickly be getting close to 100. So, yeah, the numbers are trending towards average and then in some aspects above average in terms of major hurricanes and also the number of hurricanes.
One thing, you know, it's funny. I just found this graphic and I wanted to just address it. For people that were talking about Jeremy, for people that were talking about this being like a Helene part two, here's the clear reason why that won't happen. No matter what happens in the Gulf of Mexico the next couple of days, there's that blue line that's kind of protecting your area, my friend.
Yeah, that cold front and then a high building and quickly behind it, our winds are going to start going more north-northeast, cooler, drier air. And that should help to kind of adjust the track. But we'll monitor it and keep everyone updated what's going on. I need to make my first run really outside of my home since the storm to try to get some supplies. Yeah. I need some gas. And I also have to meet with a tree person. We have trees down in my neighborhood still. And obviously, finding a tree company right now isn't the easiest task. So I'm meeting with someone. And yeah, I had a little bit of minor roof damage, shingles, some trees, big, huge limbs down, and then the power and out stuff. But I mean, that's very minor compared to what so many people are facing up the road.
Man, it's awful. But we have to keep watching the rest of the tropical story, and we will be doing that. So, all right, Jeremy, that's all I got, my friend. Anything else to add?
No, we'll be back maybe later this week or for sure next Tuesday.
Sounds good. All right. Listen, from sunny Central Florida, I'm WESH 2 meteorologist Eric Burris.
And in Savannah, Georgia, I'm WJCL 22 chief meteorologist Jeremy Nelson.
We'll see you guys later.